channel open. Welcome back to WeeklyTrek, a proud member of the Tricorder Transmissions podcast network and presented in partnership with TrekCore.com. I am your host, Alex Perry.
What's today's date? The date.
Today's show is recorded on September 25th, 2022, and is current through the Star Trek Lower Decks episode Reflections, so beware of spoilers. All right, let's get into the show.
Good day, Voyager, and welcome to A Briefing with Neelix. It's a catchy title, isn't it?
Weekly Trek is a regular news show covering the biggest stories from the Star Trek franchise. We are in a new golden age of Star Trek. There are 5 television shows in production, possibly more on the way, and enough merchandise to fill the Bajoran wormhole. So stick with me, and I'll help you sort the real facts from a lot of the Dominion propaganda that you'll find online. But I can't do this alone, and my guest this week is returning guest and co-host of the Starfleet Academy Awards podcast. It's Caleb Dorsch. Caleb, welcome back to WeeklyTrek.
Hey, Alex. It's always good to be here. Thank you for having me.
All right, Caleb. Well, you know the drill. I want to know something that's got you excited about Star Trek at the moment. What's got you moving at Warp 10?
I'm going to focus in on the date here. And yesterday, September 24th,
yes, sir,
was the 5-year anniversary of the premiere of Star Trek Discovery. And I just love seeing all of the love on Twitter yesterday for it. You know me, I'm a huge Star Trek Discovery fan. This is one of my favorite Star Treks, up there with Deep Space Nine. And just seeing the outpouring of support for that show 5 years after its start, because it's what gave us all of the great Star Trek we have today. And I am just so excited for that. I'm also excited for the recent tweet from Michelle Paradise saying that they finished writing for season 5 as well. So that kind of ties in. But I'm just ready for more Star Trek Discovery, and I can't wait for it to be back on our screens.
It is at the same time both incredibly hard to believe that a full 5 years has passed since September 24th, 2017, when it was a Sunday and I blocked off my whole day to watch all of the pilot episodes from the then previous 5 Star Trek shows in order up to the Discovery premiere, which was like 8:30 in the evening. So it's, in one hand, it's tough to believe that it has been 5 years since then. On the other hand, it feels like that was like 25 years ago at this point.
Right. You know, and just seeing how strong the fandom is going, you know, in the different social spheres of social media.
Yeah.
I mean, I saw a tweet from our friend Thad Haight just the other day saying, you know, around this time, in 2017, he was just starting out, you know, exploring this Trek Twitter sphere. And, you know, I've only been around the Trek Twitter sphere for about 2.5 years, 3 years now. And it's just crazy to see how much it's grown and how much love there is for this franchise even since then.
Yeah, so much has changed and so much has happened. And a lot of it is thanks to what started 5 years ago yesterday with the premiere of Star Trek Discovery. And yeah, I'm really looking forward to season 5 of the show. Very exciting that they're sort of slowly inching towards completing production for that. As you say, writing finished on season 5. Filming will probably not be too far behind, I think, within the next month or two. And then it's just a case of going into post-production. And when will they fit it into the schedule in 2023?
Yeah, and we know Picard's probably going to run in through May, and we also have Strange New World season 2, which is well ahead of Discovery in terms of the post-production process. So I imagine that we're probably looking at summer or fall this time next year. So it's going to be an exciting time.
Oh, yes. Well, let me tell you what I'm feeling good about Star Trek this week, which is the newly released Star Trek Cookbook by Chelsea Munro Cassell. I had the opportunity to get an early review copy of the book, and I talked to Chelsea a little bit about it. My interview with her is up on Trek Core, but I think this is a really cool cookbook. I mean, I know this is the 2nd or 3rd iteration of the Star Trek cookbook, depending upon how far your kind of time horizons go back. But the famous one, obviously, is the 1999 version, which was written by Ethan Phillips and a co-author. That's a cookbook. It's sort of like a mishmash of things that are in universe to the Star Trek franchise, favorite recipes from the Star Trek Voyager actors. It's sort of like a Neelix-style cookbook. This one is presented as a textbook for Starfleet Academy students about the like food of the galaxy. And there are a ton of really great deep cut Star Trek kind of foods in here. Idanian spice pudding, Hasperat, the TOS Starfleet ration cubes, you know, the like colorful cubes that use that were in the mess hall that were never explained. There's Bolian style tomato soup. That's a caretaker flashback. There's all kinds of stuff. And it's a really fun cookbook. I would not describe myself as being the world's greatest cook. I would describe myself as being somebody who can follow a recipe to a decent degree of success and not have people hate the fact that I have made this thing for them. But I'm looking forward to maybe trying to make a couple of these recipes at some point. I think it'd be fun to this one idea I have is I think, hey, Caleb, you're right here, so you should get in on this. One thing that I think would be really fun would be getting a group of friends together and doing a Star Trek cookbook potluck where we each make one of the recipes from the book and then get together and like try them all, because I think that'd be fun.
I love that. That would be perfect for, you know, Friendsgiving is right around the corner for those that celebrate Friendsgiving before Thanksgiving. That in the US at least, that would be an excellent idea. I just love some of these recipes you've rattled off here. I would say my level of culinary expertise is about the same as yours. I can follow a recipe pretty well and not get yelled at for whatever I
do. Right.
But yeah, that sounds awesome. I'm definitely going to check that out. And you've piqued my interest for sure.
All right. Well, with that, let's turn to the week's top stories.
There's a war going on, and I'm a reporter.
Well, as Star Trek Lower Decks Season 3 passes the halfway point, excitement is beginning to build for the back half of Season 1 of Star Trek Prodigy, which premieres on October 27th in the US and October 28th in all other Paramount Plus jurisdictions. At Star Trek Day a couple of weeks ago, the Trek Core team got the opportunity to chat briefly with Prodigy showrunners Kevin and Dan Hageman and with Dal voice actor Brett Gray to preview the half season ahead. As people have seen in the first 10 episodes, our show starts off sort of outside Federation space, outside of everything you know of Star Trek, said series creator Kevin Hageman. With each episode, we get closer and closer, deeper and deeper in. These next 10 episodes are going to become even more Trek, and I think people are going to love that. And about how the character dynamics will evolve over the next 10 episodes, Brett Gray said, quote, "The first half of the season was the first part of the story where the characters were discovering themselves and becoming a crew. Now we're going to start to dig into who these characters are in their past, but also who they're going to be and what their roles are going to be in the team. I think it's going to be cool to watch the obstacles they will have to face as they are coming into their own as a group instead of just individuals." And Gray went on to talk about how the setup for these episodes that the Protostar is on the run from Admiral Janeway will impact the show. "It's really smart," he said. "What better way to set up conflict than to not allow the people who stole a Starfleet ship to speak to Starfleet? It's a lot of show and tell as opposed to talk and tell, so it's going to be great to watch our crew really figure out how to navigate this world without being able to contact people or even being able to know about what Admiral Janeway wants in general. It's like playing darts, but blindfolded." The team also talked about the decision, revealed at Star Trek Day, to bring Billy Campbell's Thaddean Okona back to Star Trek Prodigy. "Very early on in the writer's room, we were talking about the greatest hits, the characters we love," said Kevin Hageman. "As a family show, we liked the colorful characters, and he was pretty outrageous, that Okona. We fell in love with that thought of what Okona would be like some years down the road living this outrageous life." Kevin and Dan Hageman also revealed that Billy Campbell had a direct impact on the character's depiction in Prodigy so many years after the outrageous Okona, petitioning the production to make Okona look more worn and scruffier than his original appearance, including the addition of the eye patch. And the Hageman brothers also revealed that the mysterious origin of Murph, which has been teased as having a deep cut Star Trek connection, will be revealed in the first episode back on October 27th. So that is something to get excited about. Caleb, are you looking forward to the back half of Season 1 of Star Trek Prodigy?
I am. I actually really, really enjoyed the first half, and I was quite surprised with how the finale ended up. So I'm ready for it to be back. It kind of has hurt to wait so long, you know. So I liked the resolution that we had in the first half of the season and how this seems to be like a second act, even though it's still the first season. It looks like they're starting a new story and progressing a lot with the characters. You know, it seems like some of the things that might have made Dal a little annoying at the beginning seem to be receding as he's, you know, getting adapted to his role, and it seems like there's a lot more teamwork going in play here. They worked really well together as a team in the very last episode, the part one finale, and I'm excited to see this Murph reveal, because I've gone through a lot of different guesses, and I have no idea what this is. The closest thing I came up with was a nitrium parasite from Cost of Living, but I have talked to Aaron Waltke when we were at Mission Chicago, and he said it was not the nitrium parasite. So I am out of luck. I have no idea where this is going to come from, but that is very exciting. I'm really looking forward to it. The little trailer that we got Star Trek Day with the Dauntless, I think this whole idea of being kind of cut off from them and having to figure out a new way to communicate, I think it presents an interesting challenge for the characters that, you know, I'm sure we've had things similar like that in other parts of Star Trek, but having it be with a bunch of kids who are brand new at this, I think that adds a nice little flavor to it. So I'm ready for it. I'm really looking forward to it. Can't wait for it to be back.
Yeah, I think Aaron Waltke has said that of all the people who have guessed the origin of Murph so far, only one person has guessed it correctly. Out of all of the guesses they received, only one person has actually correctly identified what Murph is, which is very exciting. I love it when the shows are able to surprise us in a really authentic way. And so I'm excited to find out the origin of Murph. And yeah, like, you know, it does sort of feel like the show is transitioning into what perhaps in another circumstance would be a season two of 10 episodes rather than a season 1.5 of 10 episodes, because it does sort of feel like A Moral Star Part Two was a bit of a season finale, and that the next one probably will be a bit of a season premiere. I mean, it's certainly from the perspective of it will now have been 9 months-ish since the last time we watched Star Trek Prodigy, right? That has the feeling of sort of a season-long break in between. But I love the idea that the show is sort of going to be getting more quote-unquote Star Trekky. I mean, I love the addition of Vice Admiral Janeway, the actual Admiral Janeway, and I love the addition of the Dauntless. I just watched Hope and Fear again last night as part of my franchise rewatch, just happened to coincidentally fall right before we recorded this episode and a month before Prodigy comes back with the Dauntless in it. And I really like the new design for that ship. I think it's a cool concept that they made another one, a Starfleet version of it, and that Admiral Janeway is commanding it. And I like the sort of prospect of there being some level of conflict between the Protostar and the Dauntless, which is largely based off of, you know, this sort of outside factor, which nobody can ultimately control, but has a big impact on the story over time. So yeah, I'm getting really excited for the return of Star Trek Prodigy. I'm excited for O'Connor to be in it. I'm excited for the Dauntless to be in it. I'm excited for some of the voice actors that have been announced for the Dauntless characters, like Jason Alexander, like Jameela Jamil, who will be playing various members of that crew. So yeah, it's just, I think there's a lot of fun to come in the next 10 episodes, and I'm really looking forward to kind of continuing to build out that show and enjoy it as much as possible.
Yeah, you know, I forgot that there are those other voice actors that you mentioned as well, Jameela Jamil and Jason Alexander. I think those are going to be interesting characters to see. That Anna Cohn is kind of an interesting one to me. That's kind of a head scratcher in terms of a deep cut I don't think any of us expected, but I do like that Billy Campbell had input on the character design, and that we've already seen that play out a little bit in Lower Decks with the brief cameo with the eye patch. I didn't know that was a direct decision from him. That's kind of cool. And seeing how it has connective threads to, you know, the other series already. I mean, Alex, you were tweeting about it the other day. One of your favorite parts of the Berman era of Star Trek is those connective threads between series. I think you're talking about First Contact and Hope and Fear. I think they're one of the admirals, I think, was
Admiral Hayes, yeah. Bit of a windbag.
Right, right. And just seeing those kind of little connective threads pop up amongst multiple shows and iterations of the franchise, and to see that those conversations are clearly happening behind the scenes, I think it leads to a lot of interesting stuff ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I talked at length in the Star Trek Day episode about how utterly wonderful I think it is that O'Connor is going to be in Prodigy Season 1B, like just as a decision to kind of bring back that character specifically is just such a fun one to me. And I'm, you know, sort of really excited to see how it plays out over the episodes and the impact that he has on the show. But like, I mean, just again, right, it's O'Connor in Star Trek Prodigy as a recurring character from a terrible Season 2 episode of the next Generation. Like, I love the courageousness behind that choice, right? You could easily see a writer's room looking at a set of characters and going, oh, well, we're only going to pick the ones from the best episodes, right? Rather than a very interesting character who was in an otherwise fairly terrible episode. I mean, I know it has its fans, but, you know, like, classic guilty pleasure Star Trek episode. And now he's going to be in Prodigy. It's terrific.
Yeah.
Well, the return of Star Trek Prodigy to TV screens is not the only Prodigy that fans have to look forward to in October, with the release on October 15th of Star Trek Prodigy Supernova, the Prodigy video game that was announced earlier this year. The game will be coming to multiple platforms, including PlayStations 4 and 5, Nintendo Switch, Xbox One, and Xbox XS, as well as Steam and Stadia for the PC. To generate excitement for the upcoming release of Supernova, the developer Outright Games debuted the first game footage at Star Trek Day a couple of weeks ago.
The Protostar may still have power.
Thanks to my textbook landing.
And which textbook would that be?
The one called... Don't question me, Gwyn.
Okay, Chief. Can we get the Protostar now, or do you want to keep congratulating yourself?
I'm done. Let's roll.
Turn them to scrap! That's part of the Protostar. The Watchers are dirty scavengers.
Now we know what they're using to power the energy barrier.
And since it's been a few months since we covered Supernova's announcement, here's a reminder about what the game is about. After the USS Protostar picks up strange readings from a dying star, Dal and Gwyn must race against time to save their friends, their ship, and an entire planetary system before a supernova destroys them all. Using their unique skills to overcome ingenious puzzles, endure hostile environments, and battle deadly robot armies, Dal and Gwyn must save their captured crewmates Jank and Pog, Rock Tuck, Zero, and Murph. But they soon encounter a deadly new enemy, one that will stop at nothing to destroy the Protostar and change the very course of history. A novelization of the game, which we talked about a few weeks ago, will also be released early next year. Caleb, are you much of a gamer? And do you think you'll want to check out Supernova?
So I used to be a gamer. I am not much of one anymore, but this has grabbed my interest a little bit. I played the last big Star Trek game, I think, on consoles was the Kelvin Timeline one.
Oh, yes.
Several years ago.
And I think that one was pretty bad, as I recall, right?
I quite enjoyed it, but I can see why it got a lot of knocks on it. It was whatever, you know. It was fun, but yeah. The story itself was very Gorn heavy, and that was about it, you know. There wasn't a whole lot of substance to it. But I think the game looks great. My favorite thing, honestly, is just the fact that we're starting to get merchandising that is going to bring in new fans, whether it's the video games, the action figures that are starting to populate from Playmates in stores. There's all those. I tweeted about the plushes from, I think, Kid Robot, I think. I tweeted about those the other day.
I've got the badgy plushie from Kid Robot staring its creepy smile fixed upon me from just across my office.
Yeah, and they're great. Like, it's just cool to see Star Trek things start to populate stores again, where, you know, that other sci-fi franchise, more fantasy franchise that has Star in its name that we won't talk about, is just so heavy on their merchandising, and that's leading to its success with all of its different iterations. And to now see Star Trek finally take up some of that space again is really, really cool. So I'm very excited about this game. I may still grab it. We'll see. And then the thing that actually has me even more interested is this novelization that's going to come with it.
Yep.
And the fact that it's coming in hardcover and paperback, that's kind of an interesting choice for a book that is tied to a video game based on a kid's show. And so it makes me wonder, is this going to be more of a young adult type of thing? Is it going to be, you know, kind of a deeper dive into the story that was wide reaching for all Treklit fans? I'm kind of curious about that. And, you know, meandered on Treklit. So that, I think I'm more interested in grabbing that and at least figuring out what the story is about, and then maybe going back and seeing if it's worth picking up the game as well.
I think it has been described as a middle grade novel.
Middle grade, yeah.
But unclear exactly like what kind of grade level they're pitching it to, and therefore, you know, how kind of enjoyable or accessible it will be for, I mean, it will be accessible for everybody if it's a middle grade novel, because it's specifically written to children who don't potentially have as adept of a reading style yet. But I'm excited for this. So I would have never really described myself as a gamer, but at various points in time, I would have described myself as a Star Trek gamer specifically. I have played a lot of the old PC games from the 90s, Birth of the Federation, Armada 2, Elite 4, Starfleet Command, A Final Unity, Starfleet Academy, Klingon Academy, Away Team, Hidden Evil. There was that Conquest Q one. So what did I just name? 11. And then there was Starfleet Command 2, Starship Creator.
The Klingon video game, VCR game that you picked up as well.
Star Trek Klingon, Star Trek Borg. Although I, for some reason, never got my hand on either of those. There was the Deep Space Nine game, Harbinger. So I've just named sort of 14 games that I play, and I played all the ones I named. And so, yeah, I would describe myself as a bit of a Star Trek gamer. It's been easy to describe yourself as a Star Trek gamer and not also play video games at the same time over the last decade and a half, because there's not really been a lot of Star Trek video games. Like, I mean, you know, sort of obviously there's been mobile games and stuff, but I'm talking more about the, you know, sort of larger console or PC releases. But now we have two coming up in the space of a year, right? We have Supernova for Star Trek Prodigy, and then we have Resurgence, which we'll talk about a little bit because there's a comic tie-in with it. But we have Resurgence 2, which is sort of pitched in an adult crowd, new story, you know, sort of your classic story-based choice game that, you know, is supposed to tell a story and an episode of Star Trek. So as somebody who has not played video games in a long time, I did get the GOG.com re-releases of a couple of them, though I will confess I haven't had the chance to load them up yet. I am interested to check out both of them. My wife is a gamer, so she has a gaming PC and a Nintendo Switch. And so I have the ability to access each of these games. And, you know, I think I might when they come out. I'm sort of looking forward to it. I mean, you know, the Prodigy game looks cute, right? And for the same reason that I like Prodigy the show, I like the characters and I like the sort of story and the message. And just looking at the gameplay footage, it seems like, you know, it's got all those sort of classic Prodigy dynamics to it that I really hope are appealing to not just me, because obviously who cares what I think? I'm not the target audience for Star Trek Prodigy, but is ultimately very appealing to the kids who we want to be engaged in this show and engaged in becoming Star Trek fans themselves.
Yeah. And, you know, I was looking at the gameplay and it kind of reminded me just in style, the similarities and like some of the actions that you have to take are very similar to some of the interfaces that you get with like some of the Lego, like Star Wars games and Marvel games. Like it's just like you got the coin collecting after you've defeated the, you know, five different robots near you, whatever, you know, like it just seems very easy to pick up. It doesn't seem like there's a strong learning curve compared to some games. It seems very structured well, and I think it'll make it a big hit for kids.
Yeah, I think you're right, and that's what I hope too. I mean, that sort of period of time in the 90s and early 2000s of getting all those Star Trek games was a fun one, right? It sort of tied into this sort of notion that the franchise itself was very successful, that you had the expression of the franchise taking place in multiple media formats. It was on television. television, and it was in the cinemas, and you could get it in books, and there were video games, and there were, you know, audio productions, and there were action figures, and there was this and that and the other. And it does feel like, to sort of the point you were making earlier, a lot of those pieces are slowly slotting back into place with this new iteration of the franchise. Maybe not as aggressively, right? Like, we're probably going to get 5 Star Trek books this year, where in 1999, we got 24 new Star Trek books in that year, because they were doing 2 releases a month. That's how crazy the pace of Star Trek book publishing was in the late 90s versus Simon and Schuster. Who knows if they're back in license renewal? Who knows what's going on? But like, we're only getting a couple of books this year, which hugely sucks. Figure it out, Simon and Schuster. But the books are there. We've got the Khan podcast. We've got the Playmates figures back on the shelves. We've got a huge number of comics, which is our next story. We've got video games, right? Like, these pieces are starting to come back into place for us really to kind of look around and go, huh, you know, actually, as much as the, you know, I talk about it being a new golden age every week, it's like, we really don't feel like a lot of that's being actualized now in terms of some of that sort of sense of what it was like for Star Trek to be really culturally successful in the late 1990s returning.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think it's a good sign that things are starting to trickle in. And I think, you know, we've gone through the first 5 years of this era. We've got, what's our next 5-year plan? You know,
yeah.
What other merchandising things are they working on behind the scenes that by the time we're 3 new shows ahead, what is available to us? I think it's really building out the platform with Paramount Plus, but then I think it's strong that we've got Prodigy running on Nickelodeon where kids can catch it. You know, I think what happens if you add a second kids show to that equation and make it easily accessible? Does that bring even more fans in? I think that's
right.
Definitely a possibility, you know. Is that what this potential Starfleet Academy thing could be after, you know, Prodigy has run its course or whatever? I don't even know, you know, but there's a lot of options there. And it's good to see that health diagnostic measure for the franchise that, yes, we're starting to see this come in. So I'm excited.
Yeah. And like Starfleet Academy, you know, they talked about the potential of that being a like young adult show, which is, you know, great too, because like, different Star Treks for different audiences. We've got the kids show, we've got the adult shows, and now let's layer in, you know, some sort of products for kind of, you know, for teenagers as well. Perfect. Bring it on. Well, after a relatively quiet year on the Star Trek comics front, as the Star Trek line at the comics publisher IDW underwent an editorial change, in the last month, the veteran Star Trek licensee has announced a slew of new comics projects for the months ahead that put them very much back in the driver's seat of publishing new Star Trek comics. We've got a 3-issue Lower Decks miniseries from writer Ryan North and drawn by artist Chris Finoglio, the first issue of which just came out this past week. We've also got the 3-issue Star Trek Picard Stargazer comic from Mike Johnson and Picard co-creator Kirsten Beyer, with art by Angel Hernandez, which is set between season 2 and 3 of Star Trek Picard. Both Stargazer and Lower Decks' first issues are already out. And then in the realm of the newly announced, Star Trek comics are moving into strange new worlds with the announcement of the Illyrian Enigma, also from Johnson and Beyer, with art by Megan Levins, that will be set between the events of Star Trek Strange New Worlds' 1st and 2nd season. The first issue drops in December, and the synopsis reads, with Una accused of unlawful genetic modification by Starfleet, Captain Pike sets out in search of evidence that could prove his first officer's innocence. In addition, the other big new Star Trek video game that we were just talking about, which is getting itself a multi-platform release, that being Star Trek Resurgence, will also be getting a comics prequel tie-in. The synopsis for the 5-issue series reads as follows, quote, building upon the wave of excitement for Dramatic Lab's upcoming interactive video game, IDW is thrilled to announce the 5-issue comic book prequel of the same name, Star Trek Resurgence. Exploring the calamitous events of the USS Resolute preceding the game's main storyline, the miniseries will be written by Andrew Grant and Dan Martin, with art by Josh Hood, and will debut in November. Talarians, Leia Brahms, and the Centaur-class USS Resolute, what more could you possibly want from the miniseries? And finally, to build excitement for the new monthly ongoing comic entitled Just Star Trek, that features a team-up of noted Star Trek luminaries like Benjamin Sisko, Beverly Crusher, and Day data, IDW has been marketing the series strongly to interested readers. It's the biggest initiative that IDW has ever undertaken for the brand in its now 14 years of Star Trek publication, said IDW marketing director Keith Davidson. Essentially, our new Star Trek series is creating a new ongoing IDW continuity from which we will build offshoots, spin-offs, and epic events for years to come. Benjamin Sisko takes the helm, supported by a crew of characters pulled quite literally from throughout the Star Trek canon, even from the original series. Part of the fun will be seeing how the diverse personalities mesh or clash. Honestly, we're hoping to channel with Star Trek what Marvel did when they launched their Star Wars comics a few years back, respecting the canon that came before while building a new universe for fans that's wholly unique, unexpected, and accessible. And perhaps not all that surprising given the new editor for the IDW line, Heather Antos was one of the editors for the Star Wars Marvel line a few years ago. Describing his take on the series, which takes some big swings with the return of Benjamin Sisko, writer Jackson Landing said, quote, "They're giving us a lot of access to all the toys with the understanding that at the end of it, we will put the toys back in the box. There is about a year and a half here of Star Trek timeline that is untouched, and within this, we can make all sorts of trouble as long as we put the characters that need to be back in the box for Nemesis." As a reminder, here's the synopsis for issue number one, which is coming in October. It's stardate 2378, and Benjamin Sisko has finally returned from the Bajoran wormhole, omnipotent. But his godhood is failing with every minute. Sent by the prophets on a mission to the deepest parts of space aboard the USS Theseus, he witnesses the unthinkable. Someone is killing the gods, and only Sisko and his motley crew of Starfleet members from every era of Trek can stop them. Caleb, that is a lot of Star Trek comics. You just told me before we started recording, you have a busy next few months coming up. So do you think you'll be picking up any of these new Star Trek comics?
So, you know me, I'm big on Trek Lit, but I got into Trek Lit at the very beginning of the pandemic. So I've been running through a ton of the books, and even knowing that a lot of that has since come to an end with CODA, I have a lot of interest in this potential Star Trek line that has its own continuity in the comics. I had not gotten into the comics yet, but just a few weeks ago, there was an awesome, awesome deal through Humble Bundle, which has now come to an end, but it was, I want to say, like 80 something different comics from IDW. And so I snagged it. I was like, if I'm going to get into the comics at some point in the future, this is the cheapest way to go about it.
Yeah, sure.
And you know, I've read a couple so far. I read Discovery of the Light of Kalos, and then the Aftermath and Captain Saru comic. And I really, really liked those. And I'm excited to dive into a bit more. So I might not jump into these right away, but I definitely think I'll put them on my holiday list. I love the Avatar Through Unity book set of Deep Space Nine novels, where Sisko does eventually, yep, spoilers, return. But I'm interested to see this new twist, because I'm assuming this is, you know, since that timeline has technically collapsed to some degree, even though I'm not too sure about which inflection point, if that the Deep Space Nine novels were before or after that inflection point that caused our splinters. I'm interested to see how this new timeline or new set of events between, I guess, Insurrection and Nemesis, or was Voyager and Nemesis is what they said.
Yeah.
I'm interested to see how that unfolds and what kind of twist they bring by bringing Sisko back in the fold. I'm also really interested in this Illyrian Enigma little bridge that we're getting, because I thought, you know, A Quality of Mercy is a fantastic, fantastic episode of Star Trek, but they did kind of just shoehorn that little arrest of our lovely Una at the end, yep, of that, that finale. And we know we're going to likely resolve that in the premiere or over the first couple of episodes of season two. But I'm interested in what kind of little tidbits we get that will kind of build into that story. And the Stargazer stuff too is really interesting. Like, I think seeing that Seven is eventually going to be a commander on the Titan A in Picard season three, I think this is going to build in some really interesting stuff. And then Lower Decks, I would have loved to get some Lower Decks books, but I think the comics just make more sense for Lower Decks. It's right up their alley. You get the humor in there too. I'm curious how the humor will play out in comic book form,
yeah,
rather than, you know, on screen. And so that's probably what I'm looking forward to. We've got this Dracula holodeck thing going on here, which seems really silly, but, you know, tis the season. We're coming up on the Halloween season, so I think it's good timing in October. And I like that they're really leaning into putting out a bunch of comics really quickly. So I think I will eventually check them out. Resurgence is the only one I'm probably a little cool on, just because, like you said, I'm not really a gamer. And
yeah,
I don't know if that prequel, well, it's nice there is a prequel. I don't know if it will really pique my interest enough in order to spend the time to start playing the game. So that's probably the only one I would put aside for a while. But these other ones look great, and I'm very excited for them.
Yeah, I'm really excited about this sort of... It's not a relaunch of the IDW line. They've done stuff continuously now for 14 years. But I would say over the last kind of year or so, things have felt a little thin on the ground from IDW. I think they have relied overly much on the next generation Mirror Universe timeline, which I've never been a huge fan of in the last couple of years. And so I'm pleased to see them sort of expanding out into the pieces of Star Trek comics that I did really enjoy while they were doing it, which was, number one, sort of stuff that tied into the current shows, right? So the Stargazer comic for Star Trek Picard, the Strange New Worlds comic, the Lower Decks comic, you know, kind of giving us stuff that expands on the worlds and the stories and the adventures of what we're seeing on the screen, and having that come from Mike Johnson and Kirsten Beyer, who have done a fabulous job with every one of those that they have been tasked with doing since the first Discovery comics came out. And also them doing this like number one ongoing Benjamin Sisko story. I mean, I'm really intrigued and interested by that. I mean, I think they are, you know, they're probably overselling it in terms of like its role within the Star Trek canon. I mean, they're sort of, you know, using the same thing they said for the tie-in comics to the direct show, which is it's canon until it's not. And like, I don't know, I think maybe for this one, I would prefer they just sort of embraced like, we're just kind of doing our own thing and we're going to have a good time with it and mash some characters together in a really interesting way. But like, regardless of whether it ends up, you know, you sort of consider it part of your personal canon for Star Trek or not, it's still really fun. It's a really fun idea. And the fact that they're launching it as an ongoing, which means that it doesn't have a fixed ending to it. You know, this is not a 5-issue miniseries. This is a, hey, it'll go until, you know, people stop buying it, means that there's a lot of potential there for taking the story in really interesting directions, doing really interesting things, and yeah, exploring a piece of the Star Trek timeline that has not really been examined up to this point and doing it in a really interesting way. So I'm very excited for this one. And, you know, not least because it's just taking a big swing, right? Like, it's a big swing to bring back Benjamin Sisko in any form. It was a big swing when the books did it. It's now going to be a big swing with this comic series. And they definitely knew the right way to market it to me specifically, kind of comparing it to the novel timeline in some ways and saying that, you know, obviously the novels kind of did their own thing and kind of created their own stories and futures for these characters. And now, you know, we're kind of going to do something similar with the comics. And like, I love that about the book. Part of the reason why I'm not such a big fan of Coda is just because it was such like a definitive end to that story and that process. And so I'm excited that, you know, yes, this will be an entirely new take. There's going to be nothing, I think, that they'll be drawing from the books in this, but like just that sort of philosophy of it, I'm excited to see continue in some form.
Yeah. And even just seeing some of the art on here, I think that's been my biggest selling point in my new exploration in the comics, is just how beautiful a lot of the art is. And seeing this ship design for the USS Theseus kind of reminds me a little bit about the design of this new ship that Beverly Crusher is going to be involved with in season 3 of Picard.
Yeah.
And so just seeing like kind of some interesting threads there, like an interesting choice to put Beverly, you know, with Data and Sisko, like that's a really interesting combination to me. So I'm very excited to see where that kind of turns out. But like you said, yeah, the whole canon until it's not thing, you know, right, just have fun with it. Like we have so many different timelines, you know, between Treklet timelines and comics, and you know, already Prodigy is going to make up just a whole murky set of waters with timelines that we know are coming in that show. And so it's just have fun with it, right? You know, and see what they come up with. I think it's cool that it'll be an ongoing thing. So I'm excited.
And lastly, this week, another announcement out of Star Trek Day is a new partnership between Paramount and Pottery Barn to provide high-end Star Trek homeware for your home. Launched under the Pottery Barn teen brand, but honestly, as a 35-year-old man, I'm definitely going to buy some of this. The Pottery Barn collection offers bedding, wall art, and other decor to theme your room and show your Star Trek fandom. Caleb, we were talking before, you're on the hunt for a new house. That's going to mean a bigger space. It's going to mean you're going to need some new furniture. You think any of these items will catch your eye as you are looking to deck out your new place?
It is certainly possible. The one I'm actually kind of upset about is the lunchbox. I just bought myself a brand new Star Trek lunchbox, and it's the Science Blue TOS with the science insignia logo on it. And it's nice. It's a nice lunchbox, but this one looks a lot better. And I like that there's ships on it. And I'm just like, man, I just got a lunchbox. I just have to get a lunchbox. I hope to see this be successful and expand. I would love to see more integration of the current shows into some of these things. It looks like a lot of our classic era stuff. I see a lot of Enterprise. I see DS9. I see, you know, the 1701D.
Yeah.
But I don't really see any of the new designs on here, except maybe a Kelvin Enterprise might have made its way on here somewhere. But so that's my only thing, is I hope that this is successful so I can potentially get things like this that are tied into some of these new shows. Like I said, I'm a huge Discovery fan, so that would be great. But yeah, you know, the guest bedroom always needs bedding, and you know, I'm totally on board with that. We'll see if my wife will allow it, but you know. But yeah, this looks great. I'm actually kind of impressed at the quality. It looks like really, really solid quality. Price point might be a little high for some of them. But
yeah,
that
well, that's probably that's pottery barn for you, isn't it?
Yeah, that's indicative of the quality, I guess, too. So yeah, it looks really great.
Yeah, I like these a lot. I think I'm interested in picking up the bedding set. I think the sheets are cool. I think the duvet and the duvet cover is cool. So yeah, I might it might be time for an upgrade of my personal bedding to sort of draw it into theme with the rest of the room around me, which is very Star Trek based, and yeah, kind of follow through and completely ensemble with Star Trek Pottery Barn themed bedding. So yeah, I like these, and I'm hoping it'd be nice to see a bit more, right? It'd be nice see different kinds of bedding, be nice to see different kinds of sort of other homeware items. But I think people seem to like this. I mean, I've seen some people pick up some stuff already. So again, it's like, you know, this is just something where I didn't think 10 years ago Pottery Barn would have been interested in doing anything Star Trek related. Now there's a little line of Star Trek themed Pottery Barn items, which if you want to get a nice sheet set and you want to make it Star Trek related, if you want to get nice bedding and you want to make it Star Trek related, hey, now you've got the ability to do so. Not for king size beds though. That's the only problem there, because it's the teen line. They have not made them to go up to king size beds, but that's fine because I got a full size. So, you know, I'm doing all good.
All good. Yeah. And I like the lighting too. Like, I'm really intrigued by this backlit Starfleet logo LED light, and it's got sound sync on it too. I don't know what that means, but it looks cool. And then the LED panels, any sort of lighting stuff, I'm on board with. Like, you know, check up your lighting sources. It's great. You need a good end table light while you're reading, and you've got the for me, I always used to put my Eagle Moss ships next to some of my lamps on my end table, and now it's like, well, just build the ship into the lamp, they said. Why not?
You
know?
Yeah, right.
Save some space.
All right, well, we've talked about the facts, and now let's speculate on what's going to happen in the future of Star Trek.
You make some very good points, Captain. But it's still all speculation and theory.
So each week, my guest and I give you a wish or theory we're nurturing about any of the shows or the future of the franchise. So Caleb, let's hear your theory or wish for this week.
All right, so I'm going to tie into Treklet as I normally do.
All righty.
I have just finished, as of about maybe 2 or 3 weeks ago, Star Trek Vanguard, all the way through the coda of Star Trek Vanguard, the ninth e-novella in Tempest's Wake. And my wish, I saw a lot of people potentially wishing for not a reboot, but a continuation of the adventures of Kirk and Kirk's Enterprise after Strange New Worlds has run its course. And I don't want that. What I want is a serialized show set in that era, showing all the events surrounding Kirk and his crew, all the things happening in the background. I think that's the strong suit of Vanguard. Doesn't have to be Vanguard specifically, but Vanguard is also a really great story and really helped build out that world in a time where we didn't have a lot of world building comparative to some of the things we got in the 90s era of Star Trek. And my long-term wish is that we get some sort of serialized TOS slice of Federation life, either Vanguard or something similar to that.
That's fun. I like that a lot. Yeah, I think, you know, if the desire for the Star Trek franchise, whatever point Strange New Worlds concludes, hopefully not for a very long time, is to stick around the 23rd century in some form. Yeah, I think I don't want a retelling of the events of the original series with a modern cast and, like, you know, continuing on from Strange New Worlds. That that doesn't seem all that interesting to me, even if they pitched it as being like, well, it's year 4 and 5 of TOS leading up to the motion picture. It's like, I don't know. That feels to me like that's too much. That's too much sort of directly interfering with how great TOS itself is. And like, I get, you know, all of the reasons for modernizing the look and feel of the show. But like, I wouldn't want to go too deep and too far down the path of like futzing with TOS itself just for the sake of it. But doing something that's on the sidelines, right? Doing a sort of Vanguard style tale where it's set during the same time frame, but it features different characters. And hey, maybe the USS Enterprise shows up occasionally and it's got Paul Wesley's Kirk and it's got Ethan Peck Spock on it and it's got Celia Rose Gooding's Uhura. And they kind of pop in and out once a season to say hi because they're tangentially related to the story, but not kind of critically integral to it, which is exactly what happened in Vanguard. That's fun to me, right? That's a good way of doing that and giving those characters played by those actors a continued life, but without doing too much to sort of undermine the original series itself, because I think we should still be holding that up on a little bit of a pedestal for its role in the Star Trek franchise. So yeah, I love that. Are you, so I mean, good timing, because there's David Mack's got that sort of Vanguard tie-in book coming out in just a couple of months. Are you looking forward to picking that one up?
Oh yeah, I'm looking forward to it's Harm's Way or In Harm's Way?
I think Harm's Way. Yeah.
Harm's Way. Yeah, I'm really excited for that. That was actually part of the reason I returned to Vanguard. I'd read Harbinger maybe about 2 years ago. That was the first book in the series. And then once I knew that Harm's Way was coming out, I started in January with Summon Thunder and then worked my way through all of them. But that's, the other nice thing about that too is they spent a lot of time really laying the seeds for a lot of what we see in the movies. So even then, like that pitch of year 5, 4, and 5, like you can still work in some of that stuff and lay the event into motion for what we see in the movies, but do it in a really cool way that isn't so dependent on Kirk and his crew, but more on all of these other really interesting characters that are in the background, you know, like Admiral Nagura from the motion picture. It plays a huge role in this series, and kind of seeing, you know, him in his early days and how he commanded things, you know, is really, really cool. And just, you know, again, going back to what you were saying, the greatest thing about, you know, Star Trek is that it was the Marvel Cinematic Universe before Marvel did the Cinematic Universe. And anything that could build connective threads in an era that we haven't really been able to explore outside of novels, I think would be really cool.
All right, let me tell you my theory, which is a Star Trek Lower Decks theory, because we're closing in on the end of the season. We just passed the halfway point. In a couple of days, we've got episode 6 coming out, which is a really great episode of Lower Decks. I really like 6, 7, and 8, which I've seen. I've not seen 9 or 10. So my theory is about 9. Well, it's about 10, actually, which is that I think that Star Trek Lower Decks will end with a big cameo for the season 3 finale, and I think it will sort of set up the next kind of big story for the show that will lead into season 4. Obviously, we had the Pak-led story throughout the end of season 1 and season 2, not something we've really kind of revisited so far in season 3 of the show. They've sort of set the Pak-led story aside a little bit. Whether that means that they're done with it or they just wanted to do some other stuff for a while, I don't know. Obviously, my sense is that this season, the sort of like light serialization, to the extent that there is any of that, which it's Lower Decks, so there's not really, but like the way the sort of Pak-led story showed up in multiple episodes, I think the Rutherford story is probably the one that will, which, you know, we sort of saw in more detail in this most recent episode, and maybe we'll see again before the end of the season, is the kind of story that will play through season 3. But my sense is that maybe that we will get much more information about that perhaps in the season 3 finale. Perhaps there'll be some big cameo associated with it, and that it will then sort of set up or tease whatever the kind of next Pak-led story will be for Lower Decks. So that's my thinking for where we end up by the end of this season. Caleb, what do you think about that?
Interesting. I really liked this episode, Reflections with Rutherford, and I think it does lay some really interesting ideas about, you know, him having been manipulated to some degree after his accident. So that's really cool to see. I think you're right. There probably will be a big cameo. I actually wonder if we get a cliffhanger where it sets up the finale of season 3 sets up our crossover episode with Strange New Worlds, because that will be happening probably before we get Lower Decks season 4.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's a possibility too. But yeah, I think it would be really cool to... The thing about this current season is that we're starting to see a lot of growth for the characters as they transcend upwards to bigger and better things. You've got Bold Boimler, right? You've got Wendy getting her senior science officer training. You've got Rutherford now trying to figure out what happened in his past so that he can move forward. And then even with Mariner, this potential archaeologist thing that they planted at the end of the episode, there's just a lot of growth and like coming for these characters. And I think it'd be cool to set something up for season 4 that expands on that and shows their rise from being lower deckers. I think that's largely where we're going with this show. So yeah, I'm all for that. Bring it on.
Do you have a theory or a wish for Discovery, Picard, Strange New Worlds, Lower Decks, or Prodigy that you'd like to share? Tweet them to me at WeeklyTrek or email them to me at WeeklyTrek@thetricordertransmissions.com, and I might feature your theory in a future episode. Well, that's all the time we've got for this episode of Weekly Trek. Thank you so much to my guest, Caleb Dorsch, for joining me today. Caleb, how can people contact you if they want to continue the conversation?
Yeah, I'm on Trek Twitter. So my handle is at Rogue Moog, R-O-G-U-E-M-O-G-H. And I also started a podcast, Starfleet Academy Awards. That's at Fleet Awards Pod, FleetAwardsPod. And that is all about celebrating our current era of Star Trek. We're on a little bit of a break right now because we had gotten to the natural break in season 1 of Star Trek Discovery and our deep dive reviews of some of those episodes. Now, like I've said, that we're 5 years through that, but we're going to be starting up again soon with that mirror arc in season 1 and then moving chronologically upwards and onwards. So check that out and give it a listen.
And you can find this show on Twitter at Weekly Trek and me at Alexander T. Perry. And if you enjoy the show, please consider leaving us a 5-star review on your podcast player of choice. And please check out some of the other great shows on the Tricorder Transmissions. And if you like our shows, please also consider becoming a Patreon of Tricorder, which you can find at patreon.com/thetricordertransmissions. And lastly, if you're looking for Star Trek news on the internet, I hope you will turn to trekcore.com. Well, thank you, Caleb. Thank you to all of my listeners. And until next week, live long and prosper.